Good morning. Today is March 12, 2017. This is the second Sunday of Lent. Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We are located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue at the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's has a food pantry open every Wednesday, 9 to 10:45. An outreach store open Monday through Friday, closed on Thursdays from 9:30 to 1 p.m. The Rainbow Table every Friday from noon to 1. Everyone is welcome for a meal. Midweek services on Wednesday. During Lent, we have a supper, a light supper from 5:30 to 6:30, service at 7 in the sanctuary. There is a 2 o'clock service in the chapel. And these are on Wednesday through Lent.
Good morning. And welcome to our worship service this morning. A special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area, St. John Union Church. This morning we're using the service of the word that begins on page 211 in the front of your worship book. So I'd ask that you please turn to page 211 and I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stay. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We now sing God Love the World, hymn number 323, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 323.
Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you. from Romans chapter 4. What are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor, according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works, trusts him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of God, in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Word of God, word of life.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
Also in the front pew are sign-up sheets for the spring and early summer for readers, communion systems, and the like. And one change beginning this Wednesday, the 2 o'clock service will still be held as it was in the chapel. But we are moving supper to 5:30 instead of 5, and worship will begin at 7 instead of 6:30. The reason for this is last Wednesday, from 5 to 5:30, there was only, I think, one person there who was not part of those who had prepared the food. At 5:30, then more people began to come in. So we talked about it with those who were there, and they agreed that they thought 5:30 would be better to give people time for coming home from work. And worship at 7 would be more convenient for everyone. So supper at 5:30, worship at 7, beginning this Wednesday. Now I ask that you give your attention to the choir.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir. Very beautiful. At this time, you may take out your sermon notes for To Know the Truth. John 3, chapters 1, or verses 1 through 7. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The question Pontius Pilate asked Jesus when he was examining him is a question that's still asked today. And that is that question of what is truth? People search high and low for the truth, or what they think might be the truth. But sometimes their search is hampered by the fact that they look for the truth with preconceived notions, preconceived ideas, preconceived stands before they even really examine what the truth might be. And so because they filter the answers or the information through their already preconceived notions and ideas, they oftentimes miss the truth when it is staring them right in the face. Today, in our gospel reading, a Pharisee comes in the middle of the night to Jesus searching for the truth. Nicodemus, a Pharisee, and from what we learn later in the scriptures, a member of the Sanhedrin and evidently a man of some wealth, comes to Jesus in the night because he does not want his fellow Pharisees to see him talking with Jesus and being accused of being a follower of Jesus, which would put him in a bad standing with his fellow Pharisees and could possibly threaten his place on the Sanhedrin. So he comes to Jesus wanting to know who Jesus is and what Jesus is preaching. And like so many, he misunderstands Jesus' message and his teaching. Just like people today still misunderstand God's action in Jesus Christ because they have a preconceived view of who Jesus is and what Jesus is all about. Or they have a preconceived notion as to what they want from Jesus. And so they misunderstand his message when they try to turn his message into a political one. Or they have trouble with Jesus when they try to turn his message into a social message. Instead of realizing that Jesus is speaking about that which is most important in our lives, our spiritual life, that is not talking about the physical. He's not talking about the material. He's talking about the spiritual. And so until you're ready to accept that, you will misunderstand Jesus' message. Nicodemus, a Pharisee, one who was caught up in the messianic views of his day, must let go of those misunderstandings if he is going to be able to understand what Jesus is telling him. Nicodemus has been prejudiced, had his view prejudiced, made prejudiced by the what in the first century AD, by the Jewish people, for a Messiah who would be a new King David. A Messiah who would be a political king. A Messiah who would become involved politically and economically in the situations of the world and make Judea number one. Kick out the Romans, kick down anybody else trying to be a new Rome, and make Judea number one. So if he's Nicodemus is going to understand Jesus, he must get rid of what he knew and thought before he came to Jesus. And it is because of this idea that he made him prejudiced towards what Jesus was saying. He could not understand what Jesus had to offer when he talks about being reborn. Again, people today don't want to let go of their own ideas of God. They say they want to find the truth about God, but when it goes to searching, they already have their idea of what they want God to be like, and if he doesn't fit that mold, then they don't want to listen. But that's not how it works. If you want to know who God is, you have to look at how God has revealed himself. And God has revealed himself through Jesus Christ. So if you want to know about God, if you want to know about salvation, if you want to know about faith, then you have to look to Jesus Christ and what he has to offer. But so often, when we human beings go to look for God, when we go to look for Jesus, we think we know more than he does. We think we could have a better plan of salvation than God does. That we could do things better if they would just be turned over to us. Even we Christians sometimes develop that attitude, thinking that somehow we can add to or improve what God has done. And so fortunately, Lent rolls around each year, a time of reflection, a time of repentance, a time of recommitment and renewal. And Lent gives us that opportunity to look at ourselves and see where we stand in our relationship with Jesus Christ. Are we putting the emphasis on ourselves? Or are we putting our emphasis on what God has done for us through Jesus Christ? This was Nicodemus' mistake. Nicodemus was trying to understand things through his own understanding instead of listening to what Jesus was really saying. In our gospel lesson, there is this little word in the third verse that in Greek is anotha. In the majority of your English translations, it is translated as again. However, its number one meaning, when you look up in the Greek dictionary, is from above. So when Jesus says, as it said in our gospel reading today, you must be born from above, Nicodemus cannot conceive what Jesus is talking about because he's thinking physically and worldly. Most translations put it as born again. So Nicodemus focuses on the physical. How can I be reborn? I can't go back into my mother's womb and be born a second time. I'm an old man. So Jesus, what in the world are you talking about? And so, like Nicodemus, when Jesus tells us we must be born again, too often we think of the physical instead of thinking of the spirit. We put our emphasis on what do we do or what can we do instead of the emphasis on what God is doing and God has done. So the focus should be on from above. What is it to be born from above? What does God do? How does God bring this about? And what Jesus tells us, as he tells Nicodemus, as to begin, the beginning of understanding of being born from above is through understanding the lifting up of Jesus on the cross. As he says in verse 14, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. The crucifixion of Jesus, the cross. Jesus is emphasizing the cross as the way of this change and of this being born from above. When we emphasize the idea of born again, too often that puts the emphasis on us as bringing about the change instead of God bringing about the change in us through the cross. Because it is the cross of Jesus Christ that brings about the change in our life. Too often, when when using the phrase born again, the emphasis is turned on the individual instead of on God putting you at the center, instead of God at the center, which then turns into almost a new works righteousness, because it focuses on what you are doing. What am I doing to try to be saved? Instead of, I can do nothing. What has God done in order to save me? The cross is the center of our rebirth, and it is God's action in which we do nothing. No cross, no change, no salvation. So Jesus, in the last part of the gospel then, especially is emphasizing what God has done. The text illustrates Jesus' emphasis on the cross, as I mentioned, when he begins by saying, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. But then he goes on to explain even more powerfully what God has done for us and is doing for us through Jesus Christ when he says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent his Son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Here again is an example of where we have people develop the wrong idea of God or have a difficulty in believing Jesus' invitation because in their mind they've already conceived that God is a God who wants to condemn us, that God is a God who wants to be a judge, who wants us to suffer. And that's not the God that Jesus reveals at all. He sent his Son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved again. I don't know your experience growing up, but mine, as I've often mentioned to you, growing up in the Commonwealth of Kentucky, radio flooded by the fundamentalist churches. There were sermons I heard sometimes on a Sunday night when I was trying to go to sleep. That really wasn't such a good idea, trying to go to sleep to somebody who's preaching nothing but hellfire at you while you're trying to trip talk. It's kind of hard to go to sleep when you're hearing all about suffering and flames and demons attacking you and all this. But these type of preachers would preach, and by the time they were done, it was like, God is not wrath. God is a God who condemns. You heard nothing about grace. You heard nothing about God sending his Son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. And so it was always a relief then to go back to church on the following Sunday morning and hear that we are saved by grace through faith apart from works of the law. Belief, to have faith, explained simply means to consist of accepting something, not doing something. Let me repeat that. Belief consists of accepting something, not doing something. And the result of that belief is eternal life. That is what the truth is. That is to know the truth. Salvation is all done by God through his Son, Jesus Christ. This passage in the Gospel of John is emphasizing the power of God and does away with works of the law, because it is Jesus who fulfills that law. As human beings, we cannot procure salvation the way we procure the material and physical things we need in life. We have no part in it. We do nothing. An old evangelist had finished his revival in a small town in Kentucky, and he had taken the tent down and he was coiling up the ropes that supported the tent. And as he was coiling up one of the ropes, this young man came up to him and he said, "Preacher, said, "What must I do to be saved?" The preacher looked at the young man and he said, "Son, I'm sorry, but you're too late." And the young man said, "What? You mean I'm too late? What? Because I missed your revival, you're not going to tell me the secret of what I need to do to be saved?" The old evangelist smiled at the young man, put his hand on his shoulder, kind of patted him, and said, "No, young man, I'm not telling you. You can't be saved because you missed my revival. You asked me, what could you do in order to be saved? And I told you were too late. Because you weren't. You see, your salvation was won for you on a cross, on a hill outside the walls of the city of Jerusalem nearly 2,000 years ago. When Jesus Christ died upon that cross, he won salvation for you. It is your gift to accept. Salvation is impossible when we try to center it on human beings and human possibilities and human action. But salvation is there for those who allow God to do the salvation. This is why Jesus tells the crowds in Matthew 19:26, "With God, all things are possible." And we see that first Good Friday, when the pen thief begs Jesus to remember him when he goes into his kingdom. And Jesus tells this man who's lived a life of crime, this man who has broken probably every one of the Ten Commandments, but because of his faith in Jesus, Jesus looks at him and says, "Today, you will be with me in paradise." See, it's what God does for us. That is what is the truth. C.H. Spurgeon, the famous English evangelist, was talking to a farmer one day, and he noticed that the farmer had a weather vane on top of his barn, and on the arrow of the weather vane was a carved "God is love." So Spurgeon asked the farmer about this. He says, "What do you mean by God is love on the arrow of that weather vane? Are you saying that you think God's love is changeable, that it veers about as an arrow turns in the wind?" The farmer replied, "Oh no, sir. I mean that whichever way the wind blows, God is still love." And that is to know the truth. That no matter how the wind blows, God is still love. No matter what might be popular in society at the moment, God is still love. No matter what political party may be in control at one moment or another, God is still. No matter if the rivers are overflowing, the winds are blowing, and the trees are falling, God is still love. And we see that love most completely in the cross of Jesus Christ. For it is in that cross you know the truth, that God truly did love the world so much that he sent his Son not to condemn the world, but the world might be saved through him. The cross brings us forgiveness and enables us to have the power to forgive others as God forgives us. That is to know the truth. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us now sing softly, tenderly, "Jesus is Calling," hymn number 608 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 608.
Thank you.
page 217, in front of your worship book, to the words of the Apostles' Creed. I invite in those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we journey the Easter fountain of life, let us pray for the world, the church, and for all people according to their needs. Our response today is, Lord, have mercy. That all nations and families of the earth be blessed through the church's witness of your love, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That those who will be born of water in the Spirit at Easter may grow in grace and faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That those who are homeless and all refugees of war may find safety and relief from their suffering, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That all who suffer in mind, body, or spirit may be strengthened and encouraged in the knowledge of God's love for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may honor all the saints who have trusted in Christ, who was lifted on the cross for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Hear our prayers, O merciful God, as we eagerly await the day of resurrection through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
The ushers are coming forward to get the collection plates for the offering. Our ushers today are Nelson Smith and Linda Smith.
Please turn to page 219 in the front of your worship book, and again, invite those who can't have difficulty to please stand.
Thank you.
and brought life into being. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
By your word, you called your people Israel to tell them your wonderful gifts: freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile, wisdom for life with you. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness: forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Send your spirit of truth, O God, rekindle your gifts within us, renew our faith, increase our hope, and deepen our love for the sake of the world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, strengthen, comfort, and keep us, now and forever. Amen. We conclude our worship with Lift High the Cross, hymn number 660, in the back of your worship book. Hymn number 660.
Oh,
today for joining us for our Lenten celebration. This week, Wednesday, midweek, there'll be a 2 o'clock service at 2 o'clock in the chapel, and 7 o'clock in the sanctuary with a light supper from 5:30 to 6:30. Please join us.